Welcome back. In our previous session, we have discussed about SQL structured query language. We have also discussed about the transactions. In this session, we will discuss about triggers. We have already discussed about SQL transactions in our previous session. Presently, we are going to discuss about the triggers. We will also discuss about the object-oriented object-oriented database management systems. We will also discuss object-relational database management systems. And finally, we will discuss XML databases. So in this session, this will be a long session where we will discuss about the triggers, object-oriented database management system. We will discuss object-relational database management system, and finally we will discuss XML databases. So let me start with the triggers. So what are the triggers? Triggers are basically some stored procedures or stored programs in database that usually fire on different points, like during the some DML statements, during some DDL statements, or some system level operations like shutdown, log on, log off. This fires automatically when you have prescribed to fire. Once you have declared or created the trigger, no need to activate or fire these triggers manually. It will automatically fire at the fire point when the particular condition occurs. So let me see the formal definition, the syntax of triggers, and how to enable, disable or drop the triggers in the databases. So triggers are basically a stored procedure code that is automatically executed in response to certain events on a particular table or a view in a database. For example, you can see here, when you are going to add a new record for a new employee in your employee table, you have to enter a new record for that particular employee in the table of taxes, in the table of vacations, and the table of salaries. If you are going to do this thing manually, then it is a very tedious task to remember where we have to update this table, which tables we have to update for a new coming entry. But if you have done, you have written a trigger for this particular task, then if any new employee is coming and you are going to record the record for that particular employee in the employee table, automatically the trigger will fire and create a new record in your tax table, in your vacations table, and the salaries table for that particular employee. You can also consider another example where you have a shop and it is not required for you that continuously monitor the commodities at your task. If you have written some trigger for this particular activity, and if there is a commodity and that is going below to a given particular limit, the trigger will automatically fire at that particular for that particular commodity on that particular table and column, and it will automatically order for that particular commodity to corresponding supplier. This is a very good example of trigger. One more example you can understand here, like you have a commodity shop where you have a table containing the details of some details of your commodities, having the product ID, product name, supplier name, and the price. With the time, you want to change the price of that some particular commodity. As you will change the price of that particular commodity, the history for that particular commodity will be maintained in some other table for the further analysis. If you are going to do this thing manually, this is a very tedious task. But if you have done or written some trigger for that particular purpose, as you will try to update or change the price of some particular commodity, it will automatically fire. This trigger will automatically fire and change the and record the history for that the previous price of that the previous price for that particular commodity in some Android table, and this table can be used for the analysis in the future. These are the different examples. These are not the only these examples. You will see a series of examples for the triggers if you are working with the database management systems. So this is the further definition and some examples of triggers. Apart from the DML statements, basically triggers are this is a universal thing to know that triggers usually fire with the DML statements. Apart from these DML statements, triggers can also fire along with the DDL statements and some system level operations like login, logon, shutdown, etc. Such type of triggers are known as schema level triggers. In Oracle, we used to say these type of triggers as the schema level triggers. This can be fired after creation, before alter, after alter, before drop, and after drop. These are the schema level triggers. These are going to fire at the point of alteration. This is the DDL. These are the DDL statements. Now, the syntax for a trigger. How to write the trigger? These are basically stored procedures. This is the create or replace triggers. This is the trigger name. This is the optional statement or replace. Create is used to create the trigger, and if you want to give a capability of that particular trigger, that in future if you want to change the definition of this particular trigger and without changing the name, you can provide it an option or replace. It will replace the previous trigger with the new updated trigger having the same name. But if you have not mentioned or replace information here, then if you are going to change any, you are going to make any change in the trigger and you want to save this trigger, it will give an error and saying this name trigger is already available in the table or the database. So if you want to give a capability to your trigger that in future you can change the trigger and save the trigger with the same name, then you have to give or replace option during the creation of the trigger. This is the identifier name. Trigger name can give any name here. This is the before, alter, or instead of. This is the options you are informing here when the trigger need to fire. It will fire before some statement, some particular statement we will discuss in the coming example. After some statement or instead of, this is used with the views. When we are going to use the view instead of tables, then we will use instead of. This shows insert, update, or delete. This shows basically trigger will fire before insert, before update, or before delete, after insert, after update, or after delete. Like this, you can give any possible permutation of these two statements. Like you are going to change the value of some row in a particular table and you want to do some particular task before changing this particular value for a particular row, then you have to mention before update. You are going to update basically. If you want that some task must happen after deletion of some row, you can go with the combination after delete, and you can use any more than one combination like insert or update or delete. If you have mentioned that insert or update or delete, the trigger will fire, and if you have used before here or after here, the trigger will fire either before or after depending on your point which you have mentioned here. Insert, update or delete, any of the case if occurs. This is the off column which shows on which column. This is also the statement. This shows on which column trigger need to be affected. And even this shows on which table you are going to apply the trigger. This is the referencing old as over new as and. This is again a optional statement. If you are not going to write this statement, you can directly use old as old, new as new in the coming procedures body or triggers body. This one is the for each row. It shows the trigger is going to be applied on the each row of the given table. When this is condition, this shows on which condition trigger need to fire. This is the declare section. Here you can declare variables, and this is the body section where you will give the body of a definition of your trigger. These are the executable statements where you will begin and in between this begin and end, this is the body of the statement, and you can handle the exceptions in your body or in your procedure or in trigger just ending the body. Just before ending the body, you have to handle your exceptions if required. But generally, you have to handle the exceptions to avoid the programs to lead or to terminate abnormally. So this was the syntaxes of the trigger. Now you can drop your trigger by writing this statement: drop trigger and the trigger name which are given in the during the creation of the triggers. There are two states of a trigger. By default, this is enabled. There are two states: enabled and disabled. There are two states: enabled and disabled for the triggers. By default, triggers are enabled. You can disable it, and then you can enable it. You can disable all the triggers on the table even, and you can enable all the tables which are disabled on a particular table. How? Let us see the syntaxes. This is the example: alter trigger reorder enable. This is some trigger named reorder which is given, which we have taken here as an example. Alter trigger reorder enable. This will enable our trigger that have the name of reorder. And if you want to enable all the triggers on some table, you can write this statement like alter table inventory. Inventory is your table name which we have taken here. Enable all triggers. This will enable all the triggers which we have defined on a particular table inventory. Fine. You can disable some particular table reorder. This is an example here. How? Alter trigger reorder disable. You can disable all the triggers that are given for the inventory table by writing this code: alter table inventory disable all triggers. This inventory is the table name for an example we have taken here. Fine. So this was it. This was the information about the triggers. What are the triggers? We have studied what are the triggers. We have studied when the triggers are fired. We have discussed about the schema level triggers. We have also discussed the different examples of triggers. And then we have seen how to write the triggers. Then we have seen how to enable a particular trigger, how to disable a particular trigger, or how to enable or disable all the triggers on a particular table, and finally how to draw a particular trigger from a table. This was all about the triggers. Next is the object-oriented database management systems. So let me discuss what are the object-oriented database management systems. Here we are going to learn what is object-oriented determinant system. Here we will use the term object-oriented database, or some others also used to say this as an object database. This sounds a very clear information about the OOPS technology. The programmers who are working with the object-oriented programming like C++ or Java, very much familiar with this term object-oriented. Why this concept comes into the market, we will discuss in this session. So, let me understand. But one thing is very much clear, this is a management system, data management system, that is used to manage this object-oriented databases or object databases. This is some software, a collection of programs that is used to manage the object-oriented databases or object databases. These are the same thing. These are the same thing. Fine. So let me discuss what is the object-oriented database or object database. We have already discussed about the relational databases, where the data is used to keep with the help of relations. Relations or tables. And to query this data from these relations, you use structured query language. Structured query language. But the programmers are very used to programming with object-oriented databases, object-oriented programming languages like Java, C++, .NET technologies like that. They well know about the OOPS concepts, but they don't know very much about the SQL. They know very well about the OOPS concept, object-oriented programming concepts like classes, objects, inheritance, etc., encapsulation like this. But they are not very much familiar with the SQL. They know little bit or up to their requirement about the SQL, but they do not know very much about the all the things about the SQL. This is not a universal statement. This is a general statement. They might know or may not about this relational databases. But one very good thing with the relational databases is that they are based on the mathematical background. These are based on the mathematical foundations. They have a very good support, strong support of mathematics for the relational databases. Where is the problem? The persons or programmers working with the OOPS concept or the programming languages working on the OOPS concept, they are very much familiar and very used to program with the OOPS concept. But when they are going to interact with the database, they are not very much efficient to work this relational database, because this is completely based on some mathematical aspects which is not required here in the object-oriented programming. What they were thinking? They were thinking, why there is not a database that works exactly on the same model of object-oriented programming concepts? If there is a database that is working on the object-oriented database concept, object-oriented programming concepts, then this is very much easy for them to work on the databases, on those databases, because they know well about the OOPS, object-oriented programming concepts, and the corresponding database is already also working on the or also designed on the OOPS based concepts. Like this. They don't wish to work on the relations. Yes, the different companies have given the object-oriented database concepts in the early 1880s, where the database, object-oriented database, is based on OOPS concepts. OOPS concepts means it is based on classes, objects, inheritance, encapsulation, like these terminologies. And these are pretty much common for the most programmer, the programmer that who were working on Java, C++, Visual Basic, and other technologies. Fine. This database can store objects. This database can store objects. These objects has persistence nature, means these are serializable. They can store, retrieve, or transfer, or replicate, or manipulate in the database. There is no interaction with these old relational databases. This was completely new, where the programmers of OOPS concepts or Java or C++ programmers, they can write the objects, put the data, and they can save into the database directly as an object. In future, if they require to change or retrieve this object, they can retrieve or fetch the database or manipulate the objects in the database. So this type of database has given a very good power, a very good assistance to the OOPS programmers or the programmers that those were working on the Java and C++. So this was the object-oriented database management system, and to handle this type of databases, you have a DBMS. And this is known as object-oriented database management system. You do not worry about the relations, their queries, and their structures, how they are working, how their data, how data is storing or retrieving, manipulating, and all the aspects which are given for the relations. They are worried only about their object-oriented programming concepts, and they are very well with the object-oriented programming concepts. They can now they can write their own objects and store in the corresponding database that is very much supporting. This completely supporting for the object-oriented programming concepts. These both databases are on the same model, that is the object-oriented database or object-oriented programming languages. Fine. This was all about the object-oriented database management systems. Next one is the object-relational database management systems. This was basically hybrid version of object-oriented and relational databases. Hence the name is object-relational, O-R. This is object and this is the relations, tables. Fine. We have taken the advantages of relational and object-oriented concepts. What are the advantages? This is using a very strong mathematical support for this type of databases, but there was no strong mathematical support for the object-oriented. But the virtue with the object-oriented databases is that it was very much easy for those programmers who are familiar with the object-oriented programming concepts. Now, the good things of both the databases, both the concepts have been taken. This database is taken, and the concept of object-oriented data, object-oriented database program has been taken. What was the virtue of that particular database? That was working on the object-oriented programming concepts. Then, an extension was put on the relational database management system. This extension was given here as a concepts. The core is relations. The core is relation. A new layer has been covered, has been given on the relation to give a new concept of relational database that is known as object relational database. Means you are a programmer is working with the OOPS concepts, Java, C++. He don't know about the relations. He know about the OOPS. He is going to save the data as an object. But the database management system, ORDBMS, maps this object to the corresponding table values. Like this. Means you are using the tables, but you don't know about the tables. You are using the tables, but you are working on the object-oriented programming system. And you are saving the data as objects, but your management system converts or maps this object to the relations. Finally, your data is going to save in the tables. What are the benefits here? Benefits here, it supports a strong library concept. It is very easy to understand, to work for the programmers of Java and C++ and OOPS based programming languages. Hence, there is not a requirement for understanding very much about the relations. They are well working in the object programming system. They can write and save the objects, but these objects will be converted and saved into the relational database as a as a values of tables. Fine. So to manage this concept, the database management system is known as ORDBMS, object relational databases, where you can work with the OOPS concept, but it will convert your objects into the table values. Fine. This is the object relational databases. If you want to understand this thing in some more easy way, you can write here relations, relational data model, and this is a new layer. This is the OOPS layer. Core is the relations. Keep this thing in the mind that core thing is the relation. A new extension has been given on the upper layer to these relations or relational model known as a OOPS concept. Capability to work with the OOPS concept, and the software that is converting these OOPS elements or these objects or to the relational tables, relational table values, is known as this database management system, object relational database management system. Fine. Next is the actual database management system. So what is the Edgement database management system? The Edgement database is used to store large amount of data or information in the Edgement format. As the use of Edgement is increasing in every field, it is required to have a secure place to store the HTML documents and the data in present in the HTML. The data stored in the database can be queried using XQuery, serialized and exported into desired format. There are two types of HTML databases. First is the HTML enabled and second is the native HTML. What is the HTML enabled and what is the native HTML? In HTML enabled, it is basically a relational database where an extension of HTML support is given. The data is going to store in the database in the form of tables or relations, but there is a HTML support is given. It will convert it into the HTML form when we are going to extract, or if we are going to submit some HTML document, it will convert from HTML to the relational values. These are the known as HTML enabled databases. And second one is, what is about the native database, native HTML database? This is basically a container like structure where HTML documents can be stored, or the data which are in HTML can be stored. This one. Native HTML database is based on the container rather than table format. It can store HTML, store large amount of HTML document and data. Native HTML database is queried by XPath expression. This gives a security to the stored HTML documents. Native HTML database has advantage over the HTML enabled databases. It is highly capable to store, query, and maintain the HTML databases, HTML documents than HTML enabled databases. Fine. Let us see an example of an HTML database. Expand this thing some more. This is a XML code like see this thing, contact info, contact one, name Vijay Kumar, company IBM, phone this one, contact one closed, contact two Arvind Rai, company name Oracle, phone this one, contact 2 is closed. You can see here this behaves like two records, contact 1 and contact 2 are from table contact info having two record values, contact 1 Vijay Kumar IBM this phone number, contact 2 Arvind Rai Oracle this mobile number, this phone number. This behaves like two records of a table known as contact info. Fine. This is way to represent. This is very much human readable. When you are going to present the data in the form of HTML format, this is very much human readable. And nowadays we are using a lot of HTML documents. Most of the data we are using are in the HTML format. Hence, there must be a way to store securely the HTML documents somewhere. So this is a very good alternate to use the HTML database that will provide you a very secure place to store a very large amount of HTML documents and their data securely. You can access this data by specified secure paths only. This is all about the basic information about the HTML databases. Fine. So hope you have understood these terms which we have discussed today about the triggers. We have discussed about the object-oriented databases. We have discussed about the object-relational. We have also discussed about the HTML databases. These are all about these terms. Thank you.